שלום, שבת שלום. כמה נעים לראות קהל צעיר באולם, צעיר מאוד אפילו. בואו בהמוניכם, בהחלט. אנא, תפסו מקומות, קבו טלפונים, התנתקו, אפשר, אפשר. אנחנו ביום הרביעי של תחרות רובינשטיין ה-17. אתם יכולים לדבר בינתיים, לי זה פחות מפריע, אבל כשהמתחרים עולים, שקט הס. אנחנו פותחים את המקצה השני להיום, שמענו כבר 18 מתמודדים מתוך ה-33, ועוד 3 ינגנו עכשיו. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, here in the Recanati Hall in the Tel Aviv Museum of Art, 17th Rubinstein Competition, 4th day, first stage, and this is the second session for today. It's all about numbers. 18 competitors have already played their first stage programs, and 3 more will play now. Ladies and gentlemen, the members of the jury, chairman of the jury, Arye Vardi. From Israel, vice chair Yocheved Kaplinski. From Poland, vice chair Katarzyna Popova-Gidron. From Israel, Taisir Elias. From Canada and Germany, Janina Fialkowska. From Japan, Noriko Ogawa. From the United Kingdom, Ronan O'Hora. From USA, Robert Levin. From USA and Bulgaria, Emil Naumov. From China, Shaohan Wang. From Israel, Asaf Zohar. Our junior jury, from Israel, Dani Dvorkin. Noah Kapelyushnik. Lior Lifshitz. Ophir Pérez, Amir Ron, from Canada, Vivian Chen, from Ukraine, Tetiana Donets. Our first competitor this session, number 19, Nikolai Khozyainov from Russia. He's 30 years old and he will play Chopin, Nocturne in C minor, opus 48, number 1, and Ballade number 4 in F minor, opus 52. He will continue with Debussy, Prelude number 12 from book 2, Feu d'Artifice, Zikukin Dinur, and he will end with Stravinsky, 3 movements from Petrushka. Nikolai Khozyainov. אנחנו מיד ממשיכים, אבל צריך לטפל מעט בפסנתר כדי שהוא יהיה מוכן למתחרה הבא. זה מוריץ, אפשר למחוא לו כפיים. אי אפשר בלעדיהם, הם עושים עבודת קודש, בדרך כלל הם מאוד בשקט, ולגמרי, הם, כמובן כשאין איש באולם. I hope we're done. So the piano can be ready for the next competitor. Thank you, thank you. אפשר, אפשר. So we're ready for our next competitor, number 20, Georgi Gigashvili from Georgia. He's 22, and he will play Scarlatti, Sonata in C major, Kirkpatrick 487, Schumann, Sonata number 1 in F sharp minor, opus 11, and Scriabin, Sonata number 9, opus 68, Black Mass, Misa Shchora. Kablu et Georgi Gigashvili.
Thank you. Thank you.
אנחנו יוצאים להפסקה קצרה ומעבירים כרת את השידור שלנו לגלריית מיזנה בלומנטל לשיחה בהנחיית הדוקטור תמרה בלטר. אתם משוחררים בינתיים.
Hello, while we are waiting for the arrival of our panel session participants from the hall, let's enjoy a recording of a past Rubinstein competition winner. Roman Lopatinsky will play Toccata Capriccio by Yoram Miyuchas. Hello. We just heard Roman Lopatinsky, who played Toccata Capriccio by Yoram Mejuchas. Hello and welcome to another panel at the fabulous Blumenthal Mizne Gallery at the Tel Aviv Museum. I'm Tamara Balter, music editor at Can Cola Musica. Today we are going to talk with three of the jury members, so let me introduce them briefly. First of all, Yocheved Kaplinsky. She is the chair of Juilliard's piano department. She has been a member of the Juilliard piano faculty since 1993, and she is an artistic advisor to the pre-college division. A native of Israel, she has served on the faculties of the Peabody Conservatory in Baltimore and the Manhattan School of Music, and she also teaches regularly at various summer festivals, including the Aspen Musical Festival and Piano Texas International Academy Festival. Ronan O'Hora, the British pianist Ronan O'Hora, has performed throughout the world, playing with the London Philharmonic, Philharmonia Orchestra, the BBC Symphony, to mention just a few. Ronan O'Hora is the head of keyboard studies and head of advanced performance studies at the Guildhall School of Music and Drama in London. Asaf Zohar is a piano professor at the Buchmann Mehta School of Music at Tel Aviv University, where he is the chairman of the piano department. In addition, Zohar teaches at the Givatayim Conservatory, as well as the Jerusalem Music Center. He received his doctoral degree from Indiana University School of Music, where he has also been a visiting lecturer. Thank you all for being with us today. Professor Ayavadi said in an interview in a previous panel that the Rubinstein event is more of a festival rather than a competition. Do you feel the same? Do you agree, perhaps in comparison to other piano competitions?
Well, since it's my first time and I'm a visitor, I can very much agree with that. I think it has a wonderful atmosphere where the sense of concert performance is at the center of what happens. One feels, first of all, these are performances. We have a job to do to then evaluate. But the important thing is that these young talents are given this opportunity with a wonderful and very responsive audience in a wonderful hall with, I think, great freedom of programming, which I think I admire very much, because it mm-hmm. gives a chance for them to, as it were, speak in their own voice. And I think it's a model of how to do competitions, never losing sight that they are really about musical performance.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think having been here several times before, I can attest to the fact that it's the audience that really makes a difference. The audience seems to be so involved and so engaged and so invested in what's going on. They're vocal about it. They're very demonstrative in their applause, and they're very attentive. And it's very rare that you see a competition that has a full house in the preliminary round. Most people wait until there are fewer people on stage. But this, from the very beginning, has a festive feeling and a feeling of something that people have been looking forward to and very happy that is happening.
Asaf, it's not your first competition.
No,
first Rubinstein competition.
It's not. I have been a competitor and I've been the secretary to the jury. And mm-hmm. This is the first time that I'm judging the competition, so I had the chance to value and to observe from mm-hmm. all categories. What my dear colleague Veda said, it's so true. It is like a regular concert. Mm-hmm. The audience applauds after every work, and yes. and they're so enthusiastic, and I can feel the adrenaline running out at those competitors, because there are some competitions that nobody, I mean, you have to wait until the end of the round to applaud, and then I can feel that the energy climbs and grows up during the performance, and it's fantastic. I love it very much.
And I have another question as piano professors. Imagine that you are just preparing, advising your students who are going to compete in the Rubinstein about the program. What would you advise a piano student in order to also increase the chance that he or she also wins the competition?
Yeah, well, that's a very good question, because this is something that we all grapple with all the time. Mm-hmm. There are certain pieces that are good for competitions. There are some that don't work as well in competitions. But basically, my advice to them is always to play pieces that they play well. Sometimes we see competitors who feel that the jury needs to hear war horses, the jury needs to hear something that is breakneck speed or difficulty, mm-hmm. and then they go beyond what they're capable of, and they show us what their limitations are. Mm-hmm. And it's much more impressive when we see a person who is playing a piece that's not quite as demanding, but plays it to the utmost, mm-hmm. and is able to execute everything there in a very comfortable and very convincing way. So it's really, it's not a one program fits all kind of mm-hmm. thing. And thank God, otherwise we would be going out of our minds. But it's definitely something that a teacher and or a mentor and a competitor need to work out together.
Absolutely, I would yes. totally agree with that. I mean, the piano repertoire is vast mm-hmm. and nobody at a serious level is going to play it all equally well, and therefore a very important sense that serious young performers need to have at stake is to begin to have a sense of which pieces in which kind of repertoire they have most to say and are most convincing. Mm-hmm. And I think, as Veda says, it's a bad idea to think, you know, this piece will automatically do well in a competition. Is it the right piece for you is a better question. Mm-hmm. Is it the piece where your voice can be heard? Because we all, speak beside very experienced colleagues, you know, one of the greatest pleasures in a competition is sometimes getting a real surprise, looking at a program and thinking, that's an unusual program. Mm-hmm. That's, and then it really works. If brought off properly, that can be one of the most memorable things sometimes.
Has any of the recital programs you've thus far listened to, or recital programs that are expected in the second round, surprised you? Anything that perhaps you miss, such as Bach works? Suites. I haven't seen any in both stages, 20th century repertory, except of course for the mandatory Israeli works.
Well, I really much looking forward for the mandatory mm-hmm. because it is like a tabula rasa. We don't yes. know the piece, we never heard the piece, and we have the music in front of us, mm-hmm. but then we see what really their imagination and the way that they can interpret mm-hmm. the stuff. I would like to refer to your previous question and
yes.
say that as a teacher who mm-hmm. prepares students for competition, I think that the most important thing is the tryouts before the competition. I think that it's so important that they will play those works as they're going to play it in the competition and see if it works or not. Mm-hmm. And the more the better, and then they could really try out in real time. Of course, things, surprises can happen, but I mm-hmm. think that you have to be really very ready. It's like in sport, you have to have preliminary tryouts just to see what
yes.
will happen.
Can I add to that? That's mm-hmm. very, very true, because one thing that we expect is professionalism, because the people who win these competitions are going to be put out there on stage mm-hmm. and they need to be ready and they need to be consistent and they need to have to elicit the trust from us mm-hmm. that they're ready to do it.
Yes.
And there are some competitors that learn pieces into the competition, and that's always dangerous. My feeling is always that somebody should accumulate enough repertoire to enter various competitions and then enter it, rather than put pieces down and then learn it and find out that they really are not the right pieces for them, but it's too late to change.
Absolutely. Mari Pariah has a great saying, says, you know, you only really begin to know a piece properly when you've played it in public. Mm-hmm. So because you access a different part of your consciousness in that, and therefore, exactly as Asaf said, you need experience of having had that, not simply having been in a practice studio and working on the piece.
Yes. And again, sorry for being so insistent, but for instance, when I looked over the recital programs, I saw two etudes by Unsuk Chin, and then several pieces from Musica Ricercata by Ligeti, and I think that's basically all the late 20th century or 21st century. Does that mean that piano students still don't accumulate enough 20th century, 21st century music repertoire so that they can always also introduce something, maybe even 5 minutes?
Well, I think it is a situation that's changing for the better, really quite rapidly. It would be true to say that it can always go further. It's partly a reflection sometimes of the work that goes into a particular kind of works and how often you're going to be able to use them. There is those a lot of contemporary music is obviously very complex. The competition here takes, if you like, an angle which I think is entirely justifiable of highlighting Israeli contemporary music, which I think is a great idea. Some other competitions don't necessarily do that, and so you will have a wider mix. But on the other hand, I think it's absolutely right for a competition to have a sense of being rooted in its environment. So I understand what you're getting at, but I think the trends are still getting healthier than it might appear.
That's true, but actually, what happens in many cases is that the competitors are worried about presenting pieces that the jurors may not know, and they feel that the jurors would be able to evaluate them more with pieces that are familiar to them. So, especially in cases where they need to have a compulsory contemporary piece, they feel, okay, that's enough, and the rest of it should be pieces that everybody would recognize.
I think it's a matter of proportions. I think it's so refreshing to have those works, but still, this is a Rubinstein competition. I don't know how to, I feel that here we are, for some reason, expecting to see someone more rather in the old tradition, maybe because of Rubinstein. So the standard repertoire is, I think, the most important. That's still what goes in the world, that's still what audience
true.
Would like to you to be evaluated, and of course, it's a matter of proportion. And then, if it is a new stuff and it's refreshing, then that's wonderful.
Okay, I would like to thank you all for this interesting discussion. And while we are waiting for the next competitor, let's enjoy a recording of a past Rubinstein competitor winner.
ברוכים השבים, אני מזכירה לכם להתנתק מהמסכים ולכוון את המבט ותשומת הלב רק לאזור הזה. תודה. Welcome back, 17th Rubinstein Competition, Day 4, Session 2, Competitor number 21. He is 22 years old from United Kingdom, Noah Zu, and he will play Brahms, four ballads from Opus 10, number 1 in D minor, number 2 in D major, number 3 in B minor, number 4 in B major. That was very easy for me. Noah will conclude with Ginastera, piano sonata number 1, Opus 22. Kablu et Noah Zu.
Thank you.